Well, good morning. This is Tuesday, April 7th, 2020, and we are in day 20 or day 22 of our lockdown. We're also in day 6 of going through the book of Matthew. My desire is to kind of get this finished throughout the month of April. There's 28 chapters in Matthew, so I'm thinking about doing a chapter a day, and so far that's worked out. We started out at about 30 minutes and it's kind of risen to about 40 minutes, but I don't think today will be a 40-minute one. Although there's a lot of great stuff. Just a couple updates. First of all, today is Tuesday of Holy Week. And so on Sunday, we celebrated Palm Sunday. People had palms in their living room. That was exciting. And the scripture doesn't really talk about what happened during Holy Week. Jesus was in Jerusalem. And the crowds were probably still kind of hanging around trying to figure out what Jesus was going to do. And the story picks up again on Monday, Thursday, when Jesus celebrates the Last Supper, and then Good Friday when he dies, Sunday when he rises again. But on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, there's just not a whole lot of stuff written in Scripture. So we're kind of in Holy Week, but we're not really sure what Jesus was doing. But I'm sure he was spending a lot of time with his disciples, comforting them, teaching them, training them. They're probably trying to figure out what in the world is Jesus going to do in Jerusalem also, because they, even though they'd spent 3 years with him, they probably didn't know what was on his plate and how he was going to make this all play out. So anyway, so it is Tuesday of Holy Week. We're going to go through Matthew chapter 6. Just a couple things about the coronavirus. It appears that in Arizona, there's been about 2,371 active cases and about 65 deaths. And it's kind of, I've been looking and doing, some research just to see what this is all about. And apparently, from the time you get contract the disease until the time that you get a fever, and then the fever doesn't go away, and so you get into the hospital, and then the hospital, you kind of start to go downhill because it attacks your lungs, and then you go on this thing where they intubate you. Put a tube down your stomach, put tube down your lungs actually, and then I guess they put your lungs in a coma, or they put you in a coma, and so you breathe externally, so you all the energy goes into healing the lungs. This is apparently what they do. That whole process does take about 3 weeks. So hopefully, with this lockdown, we're now in day 22. All the people are saying that we're going to start now seeing maybe a decline in the number of active cases and that sort of thing. I don't know. We'll have to see. And I still don't know how in the world we get out of this. I'm guessing that, and there are some incredible treatments that they're investigating, trying to do trials on. One, of course, that's been in the news quite a bit is hydroxychloroquine, and azithromycin and zinc. Apparently, there's a guy I watch. It's called Medcram, Medcram, and it's a YouTube channel. And it's a guy who kind of goes through a little bit. He teaches online courses about medicine, and so he's been teaching about epidemiology a little bit. And I think back in early March, he was talking about the mechanics of what happens when zinc gets into your cell, because apparently this coronavirus disease, this thing, attaches to the cell lining, somehow it ejects RNA into the cell, and it's like the cell starts to duplicate the RNA inside the cell, and it spreads throughout the whole body. And if you can get into the cell and prevent the copying machine from duplicating the RNA, things go great. And apparently zinc does that. Apparently, if you get zinc in the cell, you can't copy the RNA. And one of the things that helps zinc get into the cell is this hydroxychloroquine, although there's a bunch of other things that they're trying that are also supposed to help too. And so there, and there's another one we saw, Jennifer and I watched yesterday. It was apparently there's a patch that they're working on that has a whole bunch of little, it has the, if they can get it into your skin, it's like they did with smallpox, this one particular drug is very, very beneficial, but how do you get it into the skin? And so apparently somebody's come up with this patch that has a whole bunch of sugar needles, and then inside the sugar needles is the dosage, and you put it on your skin, you really can't feel it. It apparently feels like Velcro, and you take it off, and that directly gets this stuff into the skin. But there's some amazing, amazing, wonderful people working night and day trying to figure out what the mechanics of this are. And apparently, that's one of the great things that'll happen is that we'll figure out why, why this coronavirus is so deadly to some people. It's not deadly to everybody. Some people just get a mild fever, but if some people apparently, even healthy people can get this thing and have really, really severe reaction or die. So, and one person's looking at blood type. Apparently, people with type O plus blood are kind of immune to it, but people with A blood are very susceptible to it. I don't know. So, and then this MedCram guy, was it MedCram? So there's two guys that are really good. One is MedCram, this doctor I was telling you about. The other one's an epidemiologist called Peak something. Oh shoot, what is his name? And he also has a really great YouTube channel on all this pandemic stuff. And so anyway, both of those guys are looking at what works, what doesn't work, and trying to cut through the incredible politicization of this whole entire thing. Anyway, so all right, so but that is where we are, and until we are released from our homes, or some people of certain immunities are released from their homes, or whatever, until they figure it out, we're going to be meeting at least through the end of April. We're going to go through the book of Matthew. And I'm so glad that you're here. If you are here joining us this morning, please say hello on Facebook. Type your name, or you don't have to type your name. You can say hello that you're joining us. Give words of encouragement. That'd be awesome. And yesterday we had an amazing visit by Amtrak. I was sitting here talking to you, and I have a window right here that looks out, and Amtrak goes by. And I love Amtrak, and that was so exciting. And it was like one of those squirrel moments, which I shouldn't do because in the middle of a Bible study for crying out loud, but I can't help myself because we love Amtrak. Anyway, so today we're going to look at Matthew chapter 6. So get your Bible out, and we're going to go through Matthew chapter 6. It is part of Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. Matthew chapter 5, 6, and 7 are Sermon on the Mount. So we had the genealogy of Jesus, the visit of the wise men. Jesus starts his public ministry, and he says, metanoiate, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near. And this metanoiate isn't repent because you're sorry for your sins, but metanoiate means change your mind. Luther said, come to your senses, because I'm going to tell you things about the kingdom that you've never heard before. And so listen to me. And then he spends 3 years teaching what that is. And now we go right into what some of those teaching are. That's the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 5, 6, and 7. Well, today we're in Matthew 6. And in Matthew 6, Jesus is attacking, how do I say, Jesus is attacking self-righteousness. And what do I mean by self-righteousness? The Pharisees and the Sadducees are self-righteous people, right? They know what the law is. They know the Ten Commandments. They know all the laws of the Old Testament. They even, create barriers in their society to make sure people don't even remotely come to violating the laws in the Old Testament. And so you get these things where you can't work, you can't walk on a certain number of paces a day, and all the things that kind of surround that. And all those laws are basically to protect people from not doing, the main law in the Old Testament. And the Pharisees and the Sadducees, though, they were people who absolutely followed the law. They knew that they were following the law, and people looked up to them because they were following the law. They knew the law. So if you said, hey, can I do this or this? They were the people you would go to and say, yes, you can do that, or no, you can't do that. They were basically the religious leaders of Jerusalem, and people looked to them for answers on what they should or shouldn't do. But also, these people were very, very self-righteous. As a matter of fact, they were so they knew the law so well, and they followed the law so well that they themselves began to believe that they were following the law. That based upon who they were and how wonderful they were and how self-righteous they were, that they were kind of God's favorite people, right? And God doesn't play favorites. God loves all people equally. If you are in the kingdom, you are his precious and loved child. And if you don't know the law perfectly, and if you don't even follow the law perfectly, you should strive for that, but nobody can. See, and the Pharisees and the Sadducees, they thought they could. And so Jesus was very brutal, spoke very many brutal things to the Pharisees and Sadducees, because they were so self-righteous. And so as Jesus is teaching the Sermon on the Mount, then he talks about how we shouldn't be self-righteous, that nobody is self-righteous. Nobody is as acceptable to God. Nobody can stand before God and say, I'm perfect, because none of us are perfect. And the Pharisees and the Sadducees, well, they kind of were. They were self-righteous. They were trying to prove to the world and to themselves that they could do it on their own. And that's basically, the sin that was in the garden. I can do it. I don't need God. And we just, as humans, we have this uncanny ability to promote ourselves. We want to look good in the eyes of other people, right? That's self-righteousness at some level, right? Whatever it is that we have or that we do, or our job or our education or our family, or all these different things that can define us, we cling to those and say, this is why I'm an acceptable person. And what Jesus says, what Jesus always says, is you are an acceptable person because you're in the kingdom. I'm the king. I have chosen you. You are in the kingdom. Now live as a child of the king. I mean, and what greater thing is there in life to know that you are loved by God? And all these other things are secondary to living in the kingdom. So Jesus is going to talk to about that this morning. And he has just a different bunch of ways that people show their own self-righteousness. Okay? So we're going to begin in chapter 6, verse 1. And so Jesus says, be careful not to practice your righteousness in front of others to be seen by them. If you do, you will have no reward from your Father in heaven. So again, Jesus is saying, beware when you practice your self-righteousness. If you're looking inward to yourself to say, this is why I'm such a wonderful person, beware of that. Because at some point, you might look so far inward to say, I'm so far wonderful, that you lose kind of the humanity of humanity and you don't help the world around you. You say, well, I'm so wonderful. Who cares about everybody else? Be careful of practicing your righteousness in front of others. So then he goes on, and this is verse 2, Jesus. So when you give to the needy, do not announce it with trumpets, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues on the streets, to be honored by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward in full. But when you give to the needy, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret, then your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. So what Jesus is saying is that one of the ways we show our self-righteousness, the one of the ways that we parade around to the world that we're so great and nobody else is, right? Or that, at least that we're so great, is that when we give, particularly to the needy, right? That we kind of elevate ourselves and let it be known to other people, hey, I just gave food to the food bank today. I just donated to this cause today, right? And we kind of pat ourselves on the back to say, look at how great we are because of this wonderful thing we did. And it's only human and it's only natural. I've been involved in very many different nonprofit organizations, and Gracious God, thank you for this day. Thank you for the life that you give us. Help us not to be self-righteous. Help us to love you. Be with us in everything that we do. In Jesus' name, amen.